Thank you, Mrs. Ferguson. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you here. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 119. We are going to be looking at a very familiar passage of Scripture this morning, and the thrust of that passage of Scripture is talking about, and the focus is, the Word of God, the Scriptures. So I thought it was fitting for our call to worship to go to the longest psalm that we find in the book of Psalms, Psalm 119, that deals with the Word, the law of the Lord, the statutes of the Lord, His rules, and open up our time together this morning hearing from the first eight verses of Psalm 119. So as we continue our preparation for worship this morning, let's hear from the Word of God. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep His testimonies, who seek Him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in His ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules. I will keep your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. Let's pray together. Father, we are thankful that we have your word before us this morning. What a privilege it is that in our English language, we have the Word of God in an understandable way for us, that we can read it, that we can study it, but most importantly, live by it. And not only have you given us your Word, but you have given us the Spirit of God Himself to indwell in those who believe in Christ. And it is through Him, the Spirit of God, that we can understand and apply and live out the Word of God in our life. And not only that, Father, it is through the Spirit of God that we can come together as brothers and sisters in Christ and worship you indeed in spirit and in truth. So, Father, I pray that as we gather together this morning on this beautiful Lord's Day that you have given us, that you would be pleased by our time of worship this morning. I pray that you would fill those who lead us in worship through song and other elements of our service today with the Spirit of God. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that we would put the distractions of this world aside for this time and be focused on your word and what you would have for us today. So we look to you for help, and we pray that you would be glorified as we seek to be edified together. All these things we pray in the name of your precious Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, let me welcome each and every one of you to Hope Bible Church this morning. It is good to see each and every one of you here this morning. Just a few things that I would like to point out from the bulletin. Actually, I have an announcement here that is written, I think, in English from Lauren King, and she wanted me to be sure to thank all of those who helped with preparing and manning the yard sale and the bake sale that we had here on Saturday. Just a little bit of inside baseball. I don't know if that's the right term to use here. I took a day off on Friday because I had a friend in town, and I came to show him the church and all of the stuff that was here. It wasn't even out on the parking lot. It was in the multi-purpose room, getting ready to come out the doors, and it was in the foyer. And I'm like, wow, is the church really going to be ready for church on Sunday? And sure enough, it was. It was a miracle. But it sounds like the sale went pretty well. Let me share what Lauren has said here. She says, the Angola prison team thanks all who participated in the yard and bank sale by bringing items or buying items. We are excited and getting near to our goal. If you like to contribute to helping us reach our goal, you can mark Angola on your envelope. Today is our last day to raise the fund. So I echo with Lauren and the rest of the team, thank you to everyone who participated in one way or the other and helped with that sale. I know that they appreciate it, and I appreciate it as well. If you take a look at your bulletin, there's just a few things I would like to highlight for you. There will be no ladies' fellowship this evening at 6 p.m. Stephanie Slusher is under the weather. We are going to be resuming our relatively new study, looking at the subject of death from a biblical Christian perspective, based on the book Fear Not by Dr. Ligon Duncan. So, Lord willing, we will continue in that time of study at 6 p.m. I also want to point out that for the adults, on Wednesday, there will be no normal prayer meeting and Bible study at 7 p.m. because of the Awana Award ceremony taking place around that same time here in the sanctuary. So just be aware of that, and Lord willing, we'll resume our normal schedule for the adult Bible study and prayer meeting next Wednesday evening. Also, in the middle panel of your bulletin, please make sure to note that we are looking forward to and already preparing for graduation Sunday, and so the details are there. And if that is something that you would like to participate in, if you have a graduate in the family, talk to Pastor Matt or Teresa, and they can help you out and give you the information that you need in that regard. A few prayer items that I would like to share with you. I got a Facebook message, rather, from Dee York, the mother of Andrew York and the mother-in-law of Stephanie York. They are currently at the hospital. Stephanie's water broke. And they are looking forward to welcoming little Violet probably today at the hospital. And I texted with Andrew a little bit, and they're already there. They're getting a room. And he said that we are excited to meet Violet. And I said, Violet's a good name. That was the name of my grandma who passed away not all that long ago. So it's kind of nice that there'll be another Violet coming into the world. So all that to say, please be praying for Andrew and Stephanie. As I heard, this is a little bit early, earlier than that what they were planning. So just be praying for a safe and easy delivery for Stephanie. Be praying for Audrey Wilhite. I heard this morning that she had a fall on Friday. That's about all I know. So if you would just be praying for her and don't know the extent of her injuries, just be praying for her recovery as well. I know that she would greatly appreciate that, and as we hear more, we will be sure to pass along that information to you. Today is a very special day. We are very glad to have Austin and Megan here for the first time, really on a Sunday morning, in Austin's new capacity as our youth leader. And we thought that it was pretty important that since Austin started officially as youth leader this past week, and taught his first youth group this past Wednesday, that it would be good to not only acknowledge them, but also to welcome them into the membership of Hope Bible Church officially. Pastor Matt has really spearheaded the search, if I could put it like this, for his replacement. And he was very careful in looking at the qualifications of the one that we were praying for and looking for that would fill his role as youth leader there for the youth group here at Hope Bible Church, and as he would assume more of an assistant pastor role here at the church. So knowing that he did that and knowing that he really led the way in that, I thought it was only appropriate that Pastor Matt would have a few words to say about Austin and Megan before we officially welcome them into membership. So I'm going to ask Austin and Megan if they would come and join Pastor Matt here at the communion table, and if the Board of Deacons would join us just right here on the side, and as we prepare to welcome them, that would be great.
Well, as they make their way here, I'll tell you a little backstory of how all this came to be, at least from my perspective. So February 1st, 2017 was the day of my 10-year anniversary, but it was also the first day that I announced to the youth group that we will be looking for a new youth leader, which was a pretty emotional evening, if you could understand. And a couple weeks after that, I was invited to preach at Brooks Bible College for one of their chapel services. And one of the very first persons I met was Austin. He led me to where I was supposed to preach and kind of got me orientated. And little did I know that when I shook Austin's hand, I was shaking the hand of our future youth leader 2 years later. This last Thursday, I was preaching at Brooks as well, and it was kind of surreal because Joshua, I shouldn't tell you this, but said, Austin's now with Matt and Andy, and Matt coming to speak is now one of Austin's bosses. So anyway, that's what he thinks. But we're excited to have Austin and Megan and Sophie here with us this morning as they begin their life and ministry here at Hope Bible Church. And this morning, when we welcome you guys into membership, it's not because you're called to serve, it's because you're our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we share that fellowship with Jesus. So Pastor Lewis, if you would, please, and we'll go from there.
Members would please stand this morning. We'll repeat together the pledge. Should be It is behind me. I want to make sure of that before I open my mouth here, and it's also on the back wall. But shall we repeat together this? Please follow me in reading this together as we do. We, the members of Hope Bible Church, welcome you into the fellowship of this household of faith. We offer you our prayers and our support that we may grow together in the knowledge and the love of God. We trust that by God's grace, we may all serve together with humility and long-suffering, upholding one another in love, diligently striving for unity and peace according to God's holy word. Our desire is that we may edify each other and glorify Him who has saved us by His mercy and love. Shall we pray together, please? Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this morning for the privilege of welcoming this couple to us, the Coons. We pray, Father, that you would be with them. Give them wisdom, give them strength, give them the needs, Father, that they have as we commit them unto you. We thank you, Lord, for the ministry that you have set before them. Bless their family as well, dear Heavenly Father. And again, we give you thanks in the name of Jesus for bringing them to us. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Greet one another this morning. Join together with brothers and sisters in Christ here at Hope Bible Church. This morning we're going to do something a little bit unusual. We're going to dismiss the children for Junior Church and Children's Church at this time. They're preparing for something for Mother's Day, I know, and also going to have their regular teaching time. So at this time, anybody who wants to let their children go, 4 to 11 years old. And to start our music time together, we're going to sing our song of the month, Jerusalem.
See him. That song has been a blessing to you. I've enjoyed singing it all month long. It goes through my mind sometimes when I'm driving the car or walking into work. What a blessing. Now an old, tried and true song, Are You Washed in the Blood?
Are you washed in the blood?
Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this time to be here together as brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, we thank you for the fact that Calvary does indeed cover it all. Father, that every one of us is born into sin, and that sin separates us from you. But your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, life was not taken from him, but he freely gave it in our stead, and he bore the punishment, the wrath that we deserve, that we might have life. Father, thank you that we can walk in here this morning as forgiven, and that when you look at us, you don't see our sin and our guilt and our shame, but you see the righteousness of Jesus Christ in our place. Father, thank you for that gift, the gift of justification. Thank you for the reality that you don't stop there, but that you continue in the process of sanctifying us, to make us more like your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your goodness to us. Father, we thank you for this opportunity in our service to give back a portion of what you've blessed us with. And each week we do this in a way that reminds us of your goodness to us, of your provision for us, and our dependence upon you. We ask that you would be glorified in this offering and this gift, and that we would be blessed by it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
That was awesome. It was so awesome that I raised my voice for that. So, however, I have to express just a little bit of disappointment. Your dad told me you were going to play the Avengers movie theme song. So, no, very, very well done. We appreciate it. May I please ask you folks to stand, take the word of God, and join me in Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. I'm going to be reading quite a few verses, beginning at verse 13. And ending at verse 35. Teresa was able to fit the entire scripture reading from the English Standard Version in the bulletin if you would like to follow along in that translation. Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13, this is the Word of God. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. May the Lord bless the reading of his word this morning. Let's pray together. Father, again, we look to you for help as we gather together to look at your word and to apply it to our lives this morning. We again give you thanks for the privilege that we have to gather together as brothers and sisters in Christ and the freedom that we enjoy in this country to worship you. And Father, as we come together as brothers and sisters in Christ, even this morning, right now, standing before you, standing before the throne of grace because of what Christ has accomplished for us, it is our privilege to pray for others of our church family who have asked us to pray. And Father, before we come to the Word and hear it preached and hear it proclaimed, we do pray that you would be with the Yorks today, that you would be with Andrew and Stephanie. And we pray for the safe arrival of Violet. And we just pray that there would be no complications, and we just pray that everything would go very smoothly with that delivery. And I pray that perhaps later today we would be able to hear the good news of her safe arrival. Pray for the grandparents, pray for Ron and Dee, and just pray for Stephanie's family as well, that you would comfort them and that you would encourage them during this time as well. Father, we also pray for Audrey, and we just pray that you would be with her as she recovers from this fall. We pray that it's not too serious and that we'd be able to find out a little bit more about it this morning so that we can pray more accurately for her and help her in whatever way that she can. Father, we pray for others of our church family in this very room who might be struggling with situations at home, in their family, things that they're dealing with at work, things that they're dealing with in relationships with others, perhaps things that they are dealing with the relationship with you. We pray for them, Father. We know that there are many struggles within our church family. And Father, even though we may not know every detail, we are thankful that you do. So, Father, we pray that you would comfort, that you would encourage, that you would equip, that you would strengthen, and that your will would be done, and that these folks who are going through ordeals and have prayer requests of their own, that they would see your good in all of this. So, Father, we're thankful that we can commit these things to you, knowing you will do what is right, and we give you thanks in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. Please remain standing. To our worship team, and thank you to Mrs. Ferguson. I don't know if I'll get in trouble for this, so I might as well get it over with right up front. I looked at the bulletin today, saw the date on there, and I was reminded that this is a very special day for me, although I can't remember quite how long ago it was. Nancy will have to say something, but I think it was 28 years ago today, Sunday night after church, I asked Nancy to be my girlfriend in the parking lot at church. She still hasn't answered me yet. So anyway, just saw that date. Doesn't come around too often on a Sunday, I don't think. So I'm probably in trouble. So if anybody would invite me over for lunch, that would be great. So express your sympathies to her today after church. I know she would appreciate that. Our time is escaping us already, so I want to just dive right into our text this morning. You're probably thinking to yourself, Andy, you go to this passage quite a bit when you have opportunity to preach after Easter. And Pastor Matt was actually kind of making fun of me this week, saying, oh, well, haven't you preached from this passage several times before? I think he said 17 or 18 times or something like that. And I'm like, yeah, but I was thinking about our time in the Psalms. As we were looking at the portraits of Christ in the Old Testament in the Psalms that David specifically in the Psalms painted for us in Psalm 22, 23, and 24. And I couldn't help but think of this passage once again where we see, as the title of a certain book goes, The Stranger on the Road to Emmaus. We see the Lord Jesus Christ. You and I, at this point, know it's the Lord Jesus Christ as we begin this narration of this account. But we see him doing something related to where we have been at for the past 3 weeks. He goes to the Old Testament to talk about himself, to show these disciples himself in the Old Testament. So I thought it would be good for us to be reminded of the authority that God the Son, God himself, puts in his word. And what we see is the Lord Jesus Christ refers to the authority of the word, of the scriptures, when helping his disciples realize what Christ has accomplished, who Christ is, and that he has fulfilled everything that was written about him in the Old Testament. So most of you, no doubt, know the context of this passage of Scripture, and I want to remind you of that. The setting is obviously on the same day of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are looking at something that takes place after the resurrection of Christ, the very thing that we celebrated last Sunday morning, Easter Sunday morning. So Luke 24 begins with women coming to the tomb of the Lord Jesus Christ on the first day of the week, Sunday. And when they arrive, as we see, the stone is rolled away and from that tomb, and inside there's no one. The Lord Jesus Christ, his body, is nowhere to be found. So the text tells us in Luke 24, verses 5 through 7, that the ladies are standing there. The text tells us a little bit before that, that they are perplexed. They are confused. And then two angels ask them, look at verse 5, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but risen." And notice this word, remember, remember how he spoke to you when he was in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. We read in verse 8 that the women, the ladies, did in fact remember the words of their master. And so they told these things to the 11 and to all the rest, but the apostles didn't believe them. These guys did not believe the eyewitnesses of these ladies. But we see Peter and John, and John's gospel fills this out for us a little bit, gives us a little more detail. And by the way, Pastor Bruce had an excellent study this past Wednesday on this account from John's gospel in John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10, where we see Peter and John running to the tomb, And he talks about the three different words that are used there in that text for our English word see. If you're interested in the notes of that study, I can provide them for you. Just let me know after the morning worship service. But they ran to the tomb, and they saw for themselves that the Lord Jesus Christ was not there in that tomb. So they departed. Peter was marveling to himself about what happened, but John says about himself that he saw and believed. So now we come to our passage of Scripture, and we encounter two other disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ traveling that very same day to Emmaus. Jesus, in their mind, is dead. His body is gone. What more was for these two disciples in Jerusalem? So it looks like they were probably on their way home to this town called Emmaus. The ESV Study Bible, the English Standard Version Study Bible, notes about this passage that this is the first of three resurrection appearances found in Luke, and, as I'm sure you could determine from our scripture reading this morning, it is one of the longest stories. I prefer to use the word account. One of the longest accounts in the Word of God. But you and I, in the time that we have together this morning, we're going to see some pretty astonishing things in this passage of Scripture. But what I want us to appreciate, what I want you and I to really realize and focus on this morning, is that a Christian's joy, a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, their joy comes from being grounded in the Scriptures. Your joy as a follower of Christ, my joy as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, comes from being grounded in the Scriptures, in the Word of God. So, there are going to be three things that we're going to take a look at in our time together. The first thing we're going to see is we're going to see a discussion on this road to Emmaus, a discussion that takes place in verses 13 through 24. Then secondly, we're going to see an exposition on the road in verses 25 through 27. And then finally, an invitation in verses 28 through 35, an invitation on the road to Emmaus. So let's take a look at this first one, this discussion that takes place in verses 13 through 24. Again, we go to verse 13. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Now, we have two disciples here, two followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we find out the name of one in verse 18. We already read about it in our scripture reading. His name, and I'm probably butchering the pronunciation, I'm calling him Cleopas. And Cleopas and this other companion, and by the way, some have suggested that maybe this companion was the wife of Cleopas. We're not sure, but either way, Cleopas was with a companion. So there are two disciples here. We know the name of one, and the town Emmaus is not mentioned anywhere else in the Word of God. But some believe that this is the same town that goes by the name of Kubibeh, because that town was 7 miles northwest of Jerusalem. So it's possible that that is the same town by a different name that these two disciples were traveling to. So not only were they walking, they were talking. And we see that in verse 14. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. Now, that must have been quite a discussion. Because if you remember, especially as we've talked about some of the events of the week leading up to Good Friday and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, it was, relatively speaking, a very busy week, beginning with the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus Christ on the Sunday before Easter, which we call typically Palm Sunday. And after that, quite a few things began to unfold that week, leading up to the arrest and the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, followed by his resurrection. So, No doubt this was one of the primary things that they were talking about as they were making their way home to this little town called Emmaus. They were deep in conversation on the road. And verse 15 gives us a little more detail about that. So it was while they conversed, is what the New King James says. ESV says talking, and again, New King James, reasoned. ESV has discussing. While they were talking, discussing, conversed, and reasoned. Important words there to kind of let us in on what type of conversation was going on here. They were not simply rehashing what had been taking place. They were not simply having a casual conversation here. This was some energetic, the New English translation uses the word debate. They were really, you could almost say perhaps they were arguing back and forth. This was a pretty energetic discussion about the events that took place and what it all meant for them. We see that what they're doing, in a sense, is they're trying to put a puzzle together. They're trying to put a puzzle together. And what's so frustrating for them as they're trying to put this puzzle together is that they don't have all the pieces. And maybe some of the pieces that they do have, they're not fitting and they're not making any sense. That's the idea here of their discussion as they were talking and discussing or conversing and reasoning, is they were trying to put together what pieces they had, and then they were trying to find the other pieces that maybe they didn't have to make sense of what has taken place, primarily with the death of their master, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what are some of the pieces that they're missing? Well, I jotted down a few here of what you could say, here are some of the pieces that they are missing. Why did Jesus die? They didn't know. They didn't fully understand why Jesus died. That was a piece that they were missing. Where is his body? That's a pretty big piece of the puzzle that they were missing. What did we miss? What do we do now? I mean, obviously, they didn't know what to do because it looks like they were on their way home. So picture in your mind these two guys, or this guy and this gal, walking down this road, and their arms are waving, and they're really having a concentrated debate, a provocative discussion about the events that have taken place. So we continue in verse 15. We see that someone interrupts them. Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Now, this is kind of Luke stepping aside and saying, let me fill the reader in on something that these disciples didn't know at this time. This is Luke letting his reader know something that the disciples in our passage don't know. Luke explains to us, he tells us that this is Jesus himself. He is the one who's drawing near. But again, the disciples don't know that. Verse 16, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. James White, an apologist out of Phoenix, Arizona, mentions this. He says, this is a miracle by Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ is purposely restraining, or as the New American Standard has, prevented the eyes of the disciples from recognizing him for who he is. So at this point, Cleopas and his other companion, these disciples, just take Jesus as another traveler, a stranger on the road with them. They have no idea that this is the risen Christ because a miracle has been performed. The power of Christ himself is restraining their eyes, their recognition. I like how the King James says their eyes were holden. And you can almost picture Jesus supernaturally having his hands over the eyes of these disciples. But why would he do that? That's to us, that might seem like kind of a weird thing to do. Jesus is risen from the dead. He knows what these guys are talking about. Wouldn't he just say, hey guys, listen, I have risen from the dead. Let not your hearts be troubled, right? I have fulfilled Scripture. That's not what happens here. He is doing this for a reason. And it's going to become very clear as we move through these verses this morning. Our Lord is holding their eyes, restraining their recognition to bring confession out of them, to help them realize that the Scriptures were fulfilled. And He is doing this so He has the opportunity to use the Old Testament, their Scriptures, to show them that this had to take place. This was fulfilled, and this is where you find your joy, the Word of God. So what He begins to do here, and this isn't the only time He does this, after being resurrected from the dead, here He begins grounding His disciples in the Word of God, because that is what they were going to need as they go and obey Christ in spreading the gospel. That is where a believer finds their joy. It is the Word of God. Is it being grounded in the Word of God? So we see this conversation interrupted in verse 17. We see that Jesus says, what is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk? And we find here in the text, they stood still, looking sad. I can just kind of imagine they're walking, they're waving their hands, they're talking. This stranger comes up to him, asks him this question, and they probably just stopped and looked at Jesus like, what are you talking about? And they looked sad. They looked glum. They looked depressed. They look like me when I have been given a cup of coffee at a restaurant and they say, that's decaf. Now, I would like to think that that's all I would do is just look depressed and look glum. That's what they could not believe. I think they could not believe that this guy on this road would say something like that. Surely he would know. But remember, their eyes are holding. They are being restrained. And so when this gentleman approaches them, they are surprised. So they stood still. They're looking sad. Their master was dead. The events that took place in the city and outside of the city were, in their view, tragic. And they had serious doubts about what they believed, however many years they were following the Lord Jesus Christ, whether it was throughout His entire ministry or part of His ministry. They began to have serious doubts about His claims that He made. So we see their response, and Cleopas is the one who answers. Verse 18, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? It's almost like Cleopas is saying, come on, surely you know. Are you kidding me? Surely you know what's been going on these past few days. It's been all over the newspapers. It's been all over social media. It's been all over TV. Surely you know what's going on here. What does that response by Cleopas tell us? Well, it tells us that what happened with the Lord Jesus Christ, and not only what happened during that week, but I think it's safe to say His ministry, His entire ministry, was well known to the citizens there, to the people in that area there. This wasn't something, as one preacher said, as I heard this morning, listening to another sermon, this wasn't something that the Lord Jesus Christ did in a corner. His ministry was a public ministry, and especially the events that took place the past week leading up to His death and resurrection was all public. It was for all to see. So this question that Luke gives us from Cleopas shows us that everyone in the area would have known what has taken place. But the stranger presses further, beginning at verse 19. What things? What things? So the stranger begins to draw out of them the contents of what we could call their emotional debate, their emotional dialogue on the road to Emmaus. And Cleopas begins to review the events of the past few days, at least, for this stranger on the road to Emmaus. So here's the review we begin to see in verse 19. And they said to him, well, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who is a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. And you know, those things are true. Jesus is in fact a prophet. He was performed mighty deeds before all of the people. But notice the tense in which Cleopas has this explanation, this statement. It's in the past tense. Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. That's important because this shows us that Cleopas and his companion and the rest of the disciples thought Jesus is dead. He's not coming back. Jesus is dead. One commentator, theologian, David Gooding, says this. He says, death and resurrection form no part of their concept of the Messiah's office and program, which is why they had not really taken in what Jesus said about his coming death. They were hoping for a Messiah who would break the imperialist dominion by the Romans by force of arms, a Messiah who managed to allow himself to be caught by Jewish authorities, handed over to the Romans, and crucified before he had even begun to organize any guerrilla operations, popular uprisings, or open warfare. What use was he? If the Old Testament promised a liberator who should not die but be triumphant, Jesus was already disqualified. Why? Because he had died. After that, it was almost irrelevant to talk about the resurrection. I think that gives us an idea into the mindset of these disciples, that even though Jesus talked about his resurrection, it didn't click with these disciples, and especially these two. So they're trying to answer the question, why is he dead? Well, they put the blame on their people. Cleopas says he's dead because of the chief priests and the rulers. We see that in verse 20, our chief priests and rulers. So Cleopas and his companion lays the blame for the death of the Lord Jesus Christ at the feet of their very own leaders. Not the Romans. Their leaders should have recognized Jesus for who he claimed to be, the Messiah. They should have known better. But instead, the Jewish leaders, according to Cleopas, paved the way for the Romans to come and put to death the Messiah by crucifixion. Sad, confused, frustrated, perplexed, to say the least. And you can see that. You can see that with the account that is given here. And in verse 21 we read, but we had hoped, again noticed, past tense, we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. So these two disciples make it very clear in verse 21 why they looked sad, as described for us in verse 17. They were hoping that this Jesus was going to be the one to redeem Israel. So their hopes were dashed. They had placed all their hopes on Jesus. He was going to deliver his people. He was going to be the one that the nation of Israel had been waiting for all these centuries. But now Cleopas and his companion make it clear that their hopes were misplaced. He is dead. It's even been 3 days and still nothing. They also give another further report, verses 22 through 23. I'm just going to encapsulate this because of our time. Certain women of the company arrived at the tomb They didn't find his body, as they reported back to the disciples, but instead they said that they saw angels who said that he was alive. Moving on to verse 24, those who were with the disciples, we mentioned them already, Peter and John, went into the tomb, found the tomb empty. Jesus wasn't there. The body was gone. It was empty. One commentator breaks it down like this. And even though there is confirming eyewitness testimony to some of the facts, they can't make that transition to what they can't see. So the account really is some silly women came and amazed us with this bizarre kind of story, but they didn't find the body. And then two of us went to the tomb and they did not see. That is their final cynicism. That's what we see. I don't see, I'm not going to believe. That's what we see from especially the men who should have known better. The ladies saw, they believed, they went and they told the guys who should have known better. But they just said, oh, these are just idle tales. These are just idle tales. And they still didn't believe. Maybe you could say John did, but for the rest, they didn't. So that leads to an exposition on the road, beginning in verse 25. We go from a discussion to an exposition, and we see that this stranger begins to gently admonish these disciples. Verse 25, and he said to them, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Verse 26, "Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" So we see the rebuke here from this stranger on the road to Emmaus. Why? Because these disciples should have known better. These disciples had the Old Testament. These disciples had the Word of God. And based on that alone, this stranger, of course, as we know him, the Lord Jesus Christ is saying, you should have known this. This is no excuse. Your ignorance is no excuse. And when I think about this, they had the Old Testament. The New Testament was obviously being lived out at that time and would be recorded later for us. But we're in a similar boat, are we not? Actually, we're in a bigger boat. I guess that's appropriate thing to say, considering all that we have that those disciples didn't have. Yeah, we have the Old Testament, but we also have the New Testament as well. We have the completed canon of the Word of God. And we have them in translations, some not so good, but some very faithful, that helps us understand in our vernacular the message of the Word of God. But not only that, we have this wonderful resource called the Internet. And on the Internet, there are so many good, solid, free resources that can help us in our understanding, in our study of the Word of God. I would like to think that when I see you guys there on your phones and on your iPads, that you're following me along in those Bible apps and making sure that what I'm saying is right in those Bible apps. But I hope it's not Facebook. I hope it's not Twitter. I hope it's not Google or anything like that. But that just goes to show what a wonderful age in which we live, that all of these things are available to us literally at our fingertips. I have all of those books in my office, and I'm thankful for them, but I barely crack them open because a lot of that is available to me over the computer, over the Internet, the same thing, and that's available to you as well. But what do we do with it? Many of us, I'm not going to speak for all of us, but many of us waste that. We waste that opportunity. We waste that opportunity, that privilege to spend time in the Word, study it, learn it, hide it in our heart, and live it out. Steve Lawson has said this, and boy, is it right. Our spiritual lives will grow no further than our intake of God's Word. Let me just say this. If you are struggling with doubt, if you are struggling with things that upset you, If you are struggling with a lack of joy in your life, don't take this as just a pat statement. Understand that our true joy comes from regular intake of the Word of God. Now, I'm not going to tell you that you're going to go to the Word of God, read a verse, and boom, all your problems will go away. That's not the case at all. I hope that would happen. That would be nice, and maybe in some ways it would. But what the Word of God does for us is as we continue to read it, to meditate on it, that will build in us endurance. That will build in us the knowledge of the one who has created us and saved us. And then when we find ourselves going through difficult times, we can go back to that well of the Word of God. Not only what we have learned, not only what we have prepared ourselves with, but we can go back and see, okay, how should I respond in a situation like this? How would God have me respond? What can I do to find joy? And if you are struggling with things that primarily is a lack of joy in your life, we need to be asking ourselves, what does our intake of the Word of God look like? When have we spent time at the foot of the Lord Jesus Christ learning from Him? Our spiritual lives will grow no further than our intake of God's Word. So the disciples, they knew the Word of God, but they didn't understand the Word of God. Therefore, they were down. They were discouraged. They were depressed. They had no joy because they didn't rightly understand the Word of God. So that leads us to verse 27, an exposition by the master expositor. And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Folks, what we have right here is the first expository sermon since the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's Christ himself, who sets himself up as a supreme example of an expositor, the expositor, explaining the text, explaining the Bible for future expositors of the Word of God. One of the first things the Lord Jesus Christ does after he is risen from the dead, after his resurrection, is on the day that he is resurrected, on the day he comes out triumphantly from that tomb, what does he do? He preaches a sermon. He preaches expositionally from the Word of God, from the Old Testament. What's the subject? Himself. Again, James White says, no one was in a class like this. These two disciples would be the first to hear him teach and preach after his resurrection. Up from the grave, he arose and preached. That's exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ did. And I've got some other quotes here I'd like to share, but time doesn't permit. As you know, Jesus is the theme of Scripture. Jesus is the theme of Scripture, and he says that himself. And he points to Scripture, and he can go through the Scriptures, the Old Testament, and say, this is where I'm at. This is what talks about me. So he begins where else? At the beginning. He begins with Moses. He begins with what we call the first five books of the Old Testament. And again, I will just give you references that perhaps he visited, that he went to, such as Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 through 15, which is what we call the proto-evangelium, the first mention of the gospel, all the way back at the beginning, that there is a prophecy made that someone will come, a seed, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. He will come and bruise the head of the serpent. That wounded seed will come and bruise or crush the head of the serpent. And that just happened, did it not, with the Lord Jesus Christ? Maybe he went to the Passover lamb as that was being instituted in Exodus chapter 12 and said, that typified me, what I just finished doing a few days before. There's other places we could go to, but time doesn't permit. It mentions all of the prophets, and we touched on some of these scriptures, especially on Good Friday, but one, Isaiah 50, verse 6, I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who plucked out my beard. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. We looked at Isaiah 53 on Good Friday and how that described the suffering servant of Yahweh and how that perfectly pictures the suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ. We, you and I, looked at the Psalms, did we not? 22, 23, and 24, and saw how Psalm 22 perfectly painted for us a picture of the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. We see his resurrection at the end of chapter 22, Psalm 22. We see because of his resurrection in Psalm 23, he can be our good shepherd. And because he rose triumphantly from the dead in Psalm 24, he is our king. He has ascended as our king. So this would have shown these two disciples clearly that God's servant, his Messiah, would suffer and die for the sins of his people. He went through all the scriptures. I think you'd safely say from beginning to end of the Old Testament, he went through all the scriptures. Verse 27 tells us he expounded himself. He explained himself to those two disciples. Well, we must move on. And we see that Christ grounded these two disciples in the scriptures. That would be the focus of the rest of the resurrected Christ's time before he ascended back in his Father. What would he be doing? Grounding his disciples in the scriptures. And out of that, his disciples found joy. Thirdly, we see an invitation on the road, beginning at verse 28. In Luke chapter 24, verse 28, we read, "So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent.' So he went in to stay with them." So they come to their destination, and they still don't know who this gentleman is. They don't know who this stranger is that have been expounding the Old Testament to them about the Messiah, about the Lord Jesus Christ. And by this time it's late, and they say, "Come on in and have a meal with us, spend the night, and don't travel any further in this late hour." So they wrap up their time together, beginning in verse 30. "When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them." Verse 31, "And their eyes were opened." It's like the Lord Jesus Christ took his hands away from their eyes, and they recognized him. So this stranger at their table takes the place of the host. And no doubt he does something that his disciples saw him do many times before as they followed him during those years of earthly ministry. He took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. That is when they recognize, "Oh, wow, this is Christ. This is our Lord. He is not dead. He is alive." Can you imagine that? Probably not. The hopelessness that they had before, the sad, downcast faces that they were wearing before, all that was gone. They had joy. Why? Because they understood the word that was explained to them, namely about their Messiah. And then they saw for themselves the one they thought dead, their Lord, their Master, Jesus Christ. And how do they respond? Verse 32, "They said to each other, 'Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road?'" Notice this. What did he do? "While he opened to us the scriptures." Did they have heartburn? No. That's not what they're talking about here. They were overflowing with emotion because of what they experienced, because of what they learned from this master expositor. He opened up the scriptures. He opened up their understanding to the things pertaining to himself. And we see in verses 33 through 35, they make their way back and they share this good news. A disciple's joy, a Christian's joy, comes from being grounded in the Word, from being grounded in the Scriptures. When Jesus appears to the rest of the disciples later on in this chapter, in verses 44 and through 49, we see that he points them to the Scriptures, the rest of the disciples, the Law of Moses, the Prophets, the Psalms, grounding these disciples as well in the Scriptures. And in verse 45, we read, he opened their understanding that they might comprehend, that they might understand the Scriptures. Folks, that's the very thing that the Spirit of God does for you and I today. And that's what Jesus said would happen once he left. The Comforter would come, the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, God himself would come, indwell us, live in us, fill us, and instruct us in the Word. So what we see in these men is that after they had the Scriptures explained to them and their minds were open and allowing them to understand the Scriptures, they responded with joy. We begin to see that in verse 41, that joy is mentioned there. And with obedience, they preached repentance and the remission of sins in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Again, that's where our joy comes from. That's where their joy comes from, being grounded in the Scriptures, understanding it, and obeying it. And that's what we see with the disciples after the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why we see in verses 51 and 53 of Luke 24, they had what? Great joy. If you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ and you have found recently your joy waning, let me ask you, are you grounded in the Scriptures? Are you grounded in the Scriptures? Does the Scriptures inform the way that you live your life for Christ? Does the Scriptures, are they the source of comfort for you? If not, consider how your diet is, if I could put it that way, of the Word of God. Because it is only after we are regular in this book, grounding ourselves in this book, we will understand the Word of God and find our true joy. May I please ask you to stand as we close in prayer. Father, what a privilege it is to be reminded once again of the treasure trove that we have in your Word. We're thankful for this special revelation that you have given us that we can have, and I pray that we would not take it for granted. Father, I pray that you would help us to be regular in your Word, not just reading, not just checking off boxes on a reading list, but taking in the Word, understanding it, getting the sense of what it means so that we may live lives that are pleasing to you and so that we also may find comfort, strength, endurance, perseverance, and that we would have that true joy that comes from you as you reveal yourself in your Word. Father, I pray for those here this morning who don't have joy because they don't have a relationship with your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray that you would help them recognize and you would help their eyes to be no longer restrained to the gospel of Christ, that Christ came as the sinless Son of God, and that he lived the perfect life that we could never live, and that he died the death that we deserved, and he died in our place. And Father, your Word promises us that if we repent of our sins, and if we turn to Christ and Christ alone, trusting in him and believing that what he did for us was sufficient and complete, that we will be saved. Father, we're thankful for the testimony of your approval of the sacrifice of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, because on the third day, that approval was shown to us in his resurrection, the very thing that we have talked about this morning. So, Father, I pray for those who may not have a relationship with Christ, that they would allow me the privilege and the privacy of an office to show them from the Word of God how they can be assured of a saving relationship with you through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. These things we pray in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and all God's people said, Amen.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can rule this world, give me Jesus. Oh, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can rule this world, give me Jesus. Oh, when I come to die, oh, when I
God bless you. You are dismissed.